Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Baker Institute at Rice University. I'm Edward Jurecin. I'm the founding director of the Institute. This evening, we are hosting the second event of the Kelly Day Endowment on the Status of Women and Human Rights in the Middle East. I would like to begin by offering special thanks to the generous underwriters of the Kelly Day Endowment on the Status of Women and Human Rights in the Middle East and the Ghada Irani Discretionary Fund for making this important event possible. In particular, I would like to thank the endowment's advisory members who are actually with us tonight, including Mrs. Ghada Irani, who played such an important role in securing Mr. Amir Khalid's presence with us this evening. Mrs. Paula Douglas, who initiated the idea to establish this endowment, Susan Baker, and of course, Kelly Day. Kelly is the moving force of this initiative and has been instrumental in garnering the support necessary to establish this new Baker Institute research program. On behalf of the Baker Institute and our honorary chair, Secretary James A. Baker III, I would like to offer personal thanks to you, Kelly, for your efforts, and I'm pleased to welcome you to the podium to make some remarks.
I hope I did that right. Thank you for coming. The first time that my friend Ghada Irani asked me to come to the Middle East with her, I was a little skeptical, and I thought, oh, well, why not take a chance? So I went over there, and I had the best time, and I keep going back, and I met the most wonderful people, and I had a fabulous feeling of hospitality, and it's something that I really wanted people to know here, because I think that we tend to stereotype, and I think we are stereotyped as we do the stereotyping, and I think that if we could just get people to hear what other people have to say and be tolerant of their beliefs, I think the world might be a better place. I know it will take time, but we have fortunately, a wonderful man who's working towards that goal, and he is here. And I wanted to thank Ghada for showing me this part of the world and for the Bakers for doing all this with all my friends and everybody who helped. I can't even name them all. There's numerous. But I think that we have to go through understanding and not judgment, and that's the true path to coexistence. And we have to do that through exposure with our leaders, our educators, and the human rights advocates, and to enhance the public's understanding of the true status of women and human rights in this region of the world. Last year, our keynote speaker was Sheikh Al-Moza from Qatar, who presented us with a picture of the complexities in understanding rights of Middle Eastern women from a Western perspective. Tonight's speaker, Amir Khalid, is one of the most influential religious leaders of our time. I look forward to being further enlightened by his perspective. And please let me bring back Ambassador Ed Derijian, the founding director of the Baker Institute, and thank you so much for being here. Appreciate it.
Thank you very much, Kelly. It is my pleasure now to introduce tonight's speaker. Since the Baker Institute's inception, we have underscored what we've characterized as the underestimated role of religion and culture in history and policy formulation, and the importance of dialogue in building bridges between and amongst cultures. In fact, one of our earliest studies in 1995 was on United States policy toward the Muslim world and was entitled The Arc of Crisis. The urgency of addressing these issues, especially in the broader Middle East, became acute in the wake of the attacks of September 11, 2001, when there was much ill-advised and counterproductive talk of the impending clash of civilizations, which you've heard much about. Let me suggest that the real challenge is not any particular religion. Rather, the challenge is extremism of either a religious or secular guise, and the need to marginalize the extremists within any culture. Also, there is a real need for interfaith dialogue and exchanges. In this context, our speaker is a true pioneer. As the world's most watched Muslim televangelist, he has been an innovator in harnessing modern technology in the service of his faith. He has been compared to Billy Graham and Houston's own Joel Olstein in his mastery of the medium of television and his magic touch as a preacher. One thing is certain, in just a decade, he has already placed an indelible mark on Islam's critical internal dialogue on the role of faith in the modern world. He was born in Alexandria, Egypt. Our speaker began preaching in 1990 and started broadcasting his lectures on satellite television in 1998. He quickly became a phenomenon, acquiring a mass audience of devoted listeners around the world. At a time of great turmoil in the Muslim world, he has represented an unambiguous and eloquent voice for moderation, prompting the Sunday Times of London to call him an antidote to terror. Right Start International, the foundation of which he serves as chairman, is committed to narrowing cultural divides between Muslims and their non-Muslim neighbors. But if our speaker is an innovator, he is also in many ways a traditionalist, focusing on ways by which today's Muslims can rediscover peace, humility, and generosity that represent the heart of Islam's fundamental moral teachings. Our speaker's message is a clear and compelling one. Tens of millions of Muslims around the world, many of them young people, listen to him for guidance on some of the most pressing personal and public issues of the day. But his message of individual renewal, community building, and reconciliation between peoples of different faiths is also one of universal appeal. Ladies and gentlemen, join me in welcoming Mr. Amar Khaled to the podium.
Thank you very much for this invitation. I really feel it's an honor for me to be here amongst you. Thank you, Kelly. Thank you, Rada. Thank you. I feel that it's an honor for me to be here, Mr. Secretary, and to meet you and talk here in Jim Speaker Institute. Thank you for you, Mr. Ambassador, and thank you for all of you. Actually, I prefer to, when we're going to talk about women in the Middle East and when we talk about the human rights, I prefer to start to speak in Arabic, especially for some definitions will be difficult to say it in English. And then sometimes I will talk in English and sometimes, I mean, so Dina will help me. Thank you for you, Dina. Talking today about women in the Middle East and the human rights, I'm going to talk about 5 points. The first point, what do you mean, what's the definition of human rights and what's the definition of the women rights? What do you mean? Second point, the original culture of the Middle East area and what is the original culture coming from our history or from Islam? What is the vision of this culture to women? This is the second point. When we're talking about Islam, as when Prophet Muhammad started his message, how he was looking to women? This is the second point. Third point, is there any injustice for women in the Middle East? And why this injustice? Fourth point, we are going to talk about the التحديات يعني. Challenges for women in the Middle East. The fifth point, there is some تجارب متميزة Maybe good experience coming from the Middle East. I won't talk about it. And last point will be, is the women in the Middle East, ready to, if we're talking about empowerment women, are they ready to share in a positive role in their societies or not? Let's start with the first point. What do you mean when you're talking about the women rights? أنا هتكلم بقى بالعربي وأنت تترجمي. أنا عايز أقول إن لا يمكن يكون في تعريف واحد نتفق عليه كلنا لحقوق المرأة، لأن الكالتشر بتختلف من مكان لمكان.
There is no one definition that we can all agree upon when it comes to women's rights, because it largely depends on the cultures and the backgrounds for different people.
وإذا قلنا إن هناك تعريف، فمين اللي من حقه إن هو يضع هذا التعريف؟
And if we suppose that there is a definition, once we come down to that, who has the right to define it or to make that certain definition stand?
وأنا أعتقد إن دي إشكالية ما عنديش جواب عليها سوى حاجة واحدة بس، إن إحنا لازم نقبل إن إحنا في عالم متعدد الثقافات.
And my answer to that is, I believe that is one problem. But the only answer that I have for that is that we come from different cultures and different backgrounds that influence that.
وإن سر ثراء العالم بالأفكار المتعددة هو تعدد الثقافات. وإن لو العالم كله قائم على ثقافة واحدة فقط هيتحول إلى عالم فقير في الأفكار.
The world we live in is influenced by many cultures. If one culture were to be the major influence, then it would be a very poor world in the sense of cultures. So the mixed cultures enrich our world today and make it the world that we have.
وبالتالي فاللي أنا عايز أقوله إن الحل لجواب على أسئلة كتيرة زي السؤال اللي أنا ابتديت بيه إن إحنا نقبل التعايش مع اختلاف الثقافات اللي هتؤدي إلى مزيد من ثراء العالم.
And I would wish to say that the solution to this problem that I initially suggested is to accept the different cultures that we live in.
Well, I believe in the solution to accept these different cultures is one word, coexistence. I believe in coexistence because I believe in Quran. Because Quran said very clear, we created you in different colors, different languages, different religions, different cultures, to know each other and to exchange the benefits between each other. It's very clear, this message in Quran. And another message, he said, we can create you in one nation, but we didn't. God said, we can create you in one, but we didn't, because you will exchange the good things if you start to, if there are many cultures amongst you. This is the first point. Why I'm saying that? Because coexistence means there is many parts. They will understand the culture of each other, and they will trying after this understanding to find where the overlaps areas between your culture and my culture, instead of the clash, the solution to find the overlaps area. This is the first point. The second point, what I want to say, that what about the original culture in the Middle East? وكيف تنظر هذه الثقافة للمرأة?
And how the original culture looks upon women.
وإذا كان الدين الإسلامي يشكل المرجعية الكبرى لغالبية المقيمين في المنطقة العربية، وبصفتي هتكلم عن الإسلام، فأذنوا لي أن أنا أحكي لكم عن الثقافة الأصلية اللي جاء بها النبي محمد وكيف تنظر للمرأة.
Okay. The main point will be, I'll be referencing all of this to the Islamic religion and how it looks upon women. Allow me to tell you and refer to the Islamic religion, and this will go back to the information and what we need to be talking about.
أنا إذنوا لي إن أنا هتكلم عن هذه الثقافة الأصلية اللي جاء بها النبي محمد وكيف أنها تقدر المرأة وتحترمها وترعى حقوقها وحضرب أمثلة على كده.
I will go back and refer to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and the give examples about women's rights and how they are to be treated and their rights as well.
أول نقطة الحقوق السياسية للمرأة.
The first point that will be discussed is her political rights.
النبي محمد علشان يبدأ يهاجر من مكة إلى المدينة حصل اجتماع خطير وكبير، هذا الاجتماع اللي مهد لقيام رسالته في المدينة. هذا الاجتماع حضروا 10 أشخاص فقط، اجتماع هام جدا في تاريخ المسلمين اسمه بيعة العقبة. هذا الاجتماع حضروا 10، 2 منهم نساء رغم خطورة هذا الاجتماع، لكن كانوا موجودين في الاتفاق الأول.
Okay, during the first migration from Mecca to the Medina from Muhammad, he was during his mission. It's very important to note that during that meeting, 10 of the attendants were women, and that was to discuss one of his first movements within the...
Two of the ten.
Pardon me?
There was 10, two of them women.
Two of them were women.
This is the first meeting with the top 10. He can't take the decision with them, what shall we do in our idea. Two of them was women. In this time, we're talking about 1400 سنة للماضية، إن حاجة زي كده تتم، ده معناها نظرة للمرأة غير عادية.
That occurred about 1400 years ago, and that's something really big happening at that time and in that region at the time.
الحاجة التانية، عمر بن الخطاب عمل ما يشبه وزارة، يكلف ناس بمهام في الدولة، فكان العجيب ان هو اختاره. دي حاجة كانت غير مسبوقة بين العرب، انه اختار امرأة تكون وزيرة مسؤولة عن الأسواق في الدولة، وهي اللي تنزل وتراقب الأسواق وتراقب حركة الرجال جوه الأسواق في ذلك الوقت القديم.
And also Umar bin Khattab had created a ministry at the time, and he did something that was unusual. He selected a woman for the position in which she was to monitor the commerce in the area and to overlook the commerce between men and what took place at the time.
النقطة الثالثة أو المثل الثالث اللي حضربه في المشاركة السياسية، إن القرآن اتكلم على امرأة كانت ملكة، وإزاي إن هي كانت تدير مملكتها بمنتهى النجاح والديمقراطية والتشاور. والقرآن ذكر الثلاثة دول، النجاح والديمقراطية والتشاور، وأثنى إزاي إن امرأة بتقود مهمة رئاسة دولة في ذلك الوقت القديم.
The Quran also talked about women ruling. Women rulers did their duties, in which it was about discussions, ruling, and it was something that was truly discussed at the time.
These are just examples when we're talking about the الحقوق السياسية للمرأة. النقطة الثانية، لما نتكلم عن الحقوق العلمية، مش عارف تعرفه ولا لا، ان اكتر من 50% من الفقه الاسلامي اتنقل للمسلمين عن طريق ستات زي عائشة زوجة النبي محمد، هي اللي نقلت 50% من الفقه الاسلامي للمسلمين.
Those were just examples, some of the examples of political rights for women. They also discussed the scientific rights that they get to learn. 50% of the information that was passed along were passed through women, and one of the most prominent people who did contribute to that was Aisha, who is the Prophet's wife, and she has an impact in Islamic studies as well.
ولما بدأ الفقه الإسلامي ينتشر، كان بدأ ناس عايزة تتعلم هذا الدين، فكان كتير تجد أن اللي علمت واحدة ست يعني الأستاذة ويجتمع حواليها التلاميذ في المساجد يتعلموا منها كانت ستات زي السيدة نفيسة في مصر. والسيدة دي نقلت أكتر من 40 تلميذ تحولوا لعلماء كبار على أيديها.
When this started, when the religion started to prosper and move around, a lot of people wanted to learn and learn more about and about the knowledge of the religion. The main people who helped with that were women. They were the ones who went around, they taught, and most of their students were women as well. So women were a huge factor. An example of a prominent woman who took that role is Nafisa, and she's in Egypt. She, 40 of the students that she taught actually went out and they became, the learners that they were, they became knowledgeable and professors in those regions and from what she taught.
أكتر من كده في الناحية العلمية إن أول نسخة من القرآن كتبت، أول نسخة اتكتبت من القرآن تم الاحتفاظ بيها عند امرأة، عند واحدة ست، حفصة بنت عمر. ولما نقول النسخة الوحيدة في ذلك الوقت تستطيع أن تتصور قد إيه النسخة دي كانت غالية وإيه معنى الاحتفاظ بها عند امرأة.
The first version of the Quran was initially put with Hafsa bint Umar, and that's from the scientific perspective. It just shows that the great importance of women and how dear and how valuable this book is, and it was left and kept with a woman.
أنا قلت الحقوق السياسية والحقوق المدنية بضرب بس والحقوق أسف العلمية بضرب بس examples ليها، لكن عايزة تنقل لواحدة تالتة الحقوق المدنية، حق العمل وحق الجواز إلى آخره.
So far I've mentioned the scientific rights and the political rights, but I would like to move on into their civil rights as well.
Yeah. أول حاجة حق العمل. أكبر سيدة أعمال كانت موجودة كانت زوجة النبي محمد السيدة خديجة، وهو كان يعمل عندها. وأول قرض عمر بن الخطاب كدولة أعطوه كان لامرأة اسمها هند بنت عتبة، قرض عشان تبدأ مشروع تجاري في ذلك الوقت.
With the right to work, one of the most prominent people when it comes to the right of women and women who were engaged in commerce was Khadija, the Prophet's wife. And along later on, there was another lady, her name was Hind, and she was given the first loan to start her own business.
حق الجواز، أنا حذكر قصة لطيفة. أمان went to Prophet Muhammad and he said to him, my daughter, there is two men going to want to marry her. One is very rich and one is very poor. And I want her to marry this rich man. So the Prophet Muhammad said, which one of them she like and she love? He said, the poor man. He said, لا تتزوج إلا بإذنها.
She cannot marry only unless she agrees to the person that she wishes to marry.
وبعدين أم قايل لا أرى للمتحابين إلا الزواج، اللي يحبوا بعض يتجوزوا بعض.
Only people who are in love with each other should marry, so therefore no coerced marriage.
النقطة الثالثة في الحقوق المدنية الميراث. قبل الإسلام المرأة لا تورث، ليس لها أي حقوق مالية.
And now he discusses wills. Before Islam, women had no rights in wills. Islam did give her the opportunity to take advantage of that and to have the right to own anything that's within the will.
وإذا كان بيقول الإسلام إن المرأة ترث نص الرجل، فده راجع لأن رؤية الإسلام إن هناك تكامل بين الاثنين، وإن الرجل هو المسؤول عن الإنفاق في البيت، وبالتالي هي بتاخد النص لأن جاي لها حقها من سكة تانية. دي وجهة نظر نرجع تاني في اختلاف الثقافات اللي كنت بقولها.
And if it is stated, as is stated, that women only get half of what a man gets in a will, that is for separate reasons. That is kind of goes back to the initial point of different cultures. It's the man's role to provide. He will, God makes sure that she does get her rights through man.
وبالمناسبة الناس والمعلومة دي ما حدش يعرفها كتير، مش كل الحالات في الإسلام إن المرأة بترث نص الرجل. في حالات زي الجدة وزي الابن اللي مات وساب أبوه أمه، المرأة ترث أكتر من الرجل.
There are also other circumstances where it's not that women can get the entire will. It's not only up to half, such as being the grandmother or being the wife.
The mother, if her son died and he left her and his father.
Okay, so only if the parents are there and the son has passed away.
The mother take more than the father in this situation, in this case.
So the woman ends up with more than expected.
So to say always women, half men, this is not correct. This in some cases, if he's left son and daughter, the daughter will take the half. Because she will marry and the man will, his son will marry and he... Did you understand what I mean? But يعني في الآخر هو بياخد أكتر وهي بتاخد أقل، لكن هي متجوزة واحد بياخد أكتر وهو متجوز واحد بتاخد أقل، فيحصل التكامل.
Basically it all balances out. Even though she takes only half and he takes the half, but eventually her husband will also end up with half. So eventually it balances out.
النقطة الأخيرة الحقوق الدينية. أنا تكلمت عن الحقوق السياسية وتكلمت عن الحقوق العلمية وتكلمت عن الحقوق المدنية زي العمل والزواج والميراث. خلوني أتكلم عن الحقوق الدينية.
So far we've discussed the scientific rights, civil rights, and political rights. And now I'll be covering religious rights.
الإسلام بيتعامل مع المرأة زيك زي الرجل في التكليف وفي الريورد وفي الثواب لكل عمل ديني انت بتعمليه.
Okay, Islam looks upon men and women equally when it comes to performing their religious duties. So if you do bad or you do good, you are still penalized or you are you still get the same sort of rewards. Thank you.
And when the Quran said we will give you now the very good example for the right faith. حديكوا مثل للإيمان الحقيقي.
I will give you a very true example for what believing is really.
Quran said, who is the best person you have to guide and to have to follow follow him in his faith? He said two women. He didn't say men. This is the Quran. Quran said, we want you to be like these two. And he said, Maryam. He said, Maryam, we want you to be like Maryam. All the Muslims, we need you to keep this example. Maryam is correct.
Virgin Mary.
Yeah. So this was the first example. And the second example was Asya, the mother of Musa, mother of يعني زوجة فرعون أم موسى.
Okay, the Pharaoh's wife, Moses' mother. Stepmother.
And he said that because إنها وقفت وقفة قوية جنب موسى وبني إسرائيل.
And that is because she backed him up really well for him and for the tribe of Israel.
So the two examples, one talking about Maryam, and second talking about this great woman who دفعت عن موسى ودفعت عن بني إسرائيل.
She defended Moses and the people of Israel as well.
كل اللي أنا قلته ده, all what I've said is the ideal. The what is the Islam said, and maybe you can accept this and say this is very good, and maybe you cannot accept it and say no, we still have many problems about the women rights in your original ideas or original culture. But I can say that here is again we have to find the overlap between the cultures. We have to understand this is culture and this is another culture. Let me after that ask you or say the third point. Third point is خلونا نتكلم عن الواقع الآن. وضع المرأة الآن في العالم العربي.
The third point we'll be discussing is the reality of women's situation right now in the Middle East.
أنا أستطيع أقول بمنتهى الشجاعة إن نعم هناك ظلم واقع على المرأة في الشرق الأوسط وللأسف هذا الظلم يرتكب باسم الإسلام أحيانا والإسلام بريء منه.
I can courageously say that in the Middle East there's a lot of inequality going on against women and but that they used to represent under Islam which is not true.
والحقيقة ان في سببين لهذا الظلم الواقع على المرأة الآن. السبب الأولاني تقاليد قديمة ليست من الإسلام. هناك لي لفكر الإسلام الصافي من أجل هذه التقاليد التي لا تعبر عن صحيح الإسلام.
There are two reasons. The first can be related back to culture, which doesn't necessarily reflect correctly to Islam because a lot of it contradicts what they really believe in Islam.
والمشكلة الثانية إن أصلاً المشكلة مش مشكلة حقوق المرأة. المشكلة إن ما فيش حقوق أصلاً للإنسان في العالم العربي. يعني أصلاً ما فيش حرية للجميع.
The second problem is that there aren't any human rights to start with in the Middle East, let alone to have women's rights.
So, I mean, why are you talking about women? يعني anyway, this is not the point. Let's go back to our point. So, when we're talking, there is no freedom. So, every part going to injustice the other part who most weak than him. So, it's coming like that, like that, like that, till women. The weak point, unfortunately, in the society. So, because all the society like that, all of them didn't feel freedom. So, when I feeling like that, you doing that with me, I will do it with my son. I will do it with my wife. In my opinion, this is the reasons. The reason no freedom for all of them. Second, there is traditional culture. This is not Islam. And they're trying to say this is Islam. What I said before, this is my understanding to Islam. She has all her rights. But because this traditional cultures, and because no freedom, the situation will be like what I'm going to say. Let's talk about what is the situation now. There is injustice in many things. For example, حفظ رجع للعربي. حبدأ بأمور فيها ظلم، لكن كل المصلحين في العالم العربي. وكل المهتمين بشأن المرأة كلهم موافقين إن دي لازم تتصلح وبعدين هذكر الحاجات اللي فيها خلاف.
Okay, I will give examples about the injustices and even the ones who care for the mission of women's rights, they still do agree upon the same points that I will discuss.
أول حاجة ارتفاع نسبة الأمية بين الستات. نسبة الأمية بين المرأة العربية تعد 4 أضعاف نسبة الأمية بين الرجل في الرجل العربي.
The first one would be the percentage of uneducated women. When you come to compare it, it's 4 times more than uneducated men.
تاني نقطة العنف الأسري وضرب المرأة وزيادة العنف الأسري في العالم العربي وكل المصلحين بيقولوا ده لازم يتحل بس ما حدش عارف ياخد خطوة للأمام.
Although a lot of people do agree that the following are really important and they're big problems that they need to be fixed, nobody knows how to really approach it. And that includes violence in the house, the beatings, and which is escalating.
من ضمن الظلم الواقع على المرأة جرائم الشرف اللي بتقتل فيها المرأة وتهان إهانة شديدة ولا تعامل معاملة فيها قانون أو فيها أدمية أو فيها احترام مهما كان الأمر.
Another thing that is discussed is the crimes of honor that occur quite frequently. Women are humiliated, they're not being considered properly when it comes to regulations and laws, and there are just basically no rules.
All these things, we need to take decisions. We need to work hard to change these things. One of these as well, العرف المجتمع الخاطئ لما بيتعامل مع المرأة إذا أخطأت أو انحرفت.
There's a lot of violence that falls upon women if she derails from what is usually believed to be the right path of their culture.
For example, if a girl start to use drugs and smoke drugs. If I am a father and I have daughter and son, if the son start drugs, I will deal with him. But if my daughter start drugs, he will say to her out of my house. If a son start drugs, he want money, he will going have the يسرق.
He'll start stealing.
But لكن لو البنت ابتدت drugs ومعهاش فلوس, نتيجة طردها من البيت هي بتتجه للانحراف.
For men, for boys, they would go to stealing. But as women, as a girl, she's already been kicked out of the house and she has no other source of income. She would have to go to other ways from which she can gain that money so that she can supply her drug addiction.
وإذا أنت سألت الأب ليه بتتعامل مع بنتك كده؟ يقول لك لأنها أخطأت. طب ما ابنك أخطأ. لكن عرف المجتمع هي غير مقبولة. ولو الابن وقف دراجز ورجع أبوه هياخده في حضنه, لكن البنت تطرد إلى الأبد.
The children are being treated differently. If the boy comes back and he refines himself to where he will no longer use drugs and he's just a completely different person, the father will take him back. Unlike the girl, once she's out and even if she refines and she tries to become better, due to the violence within the culture and the family, they will not accept her back.
تغيير هذه الأشياء محتاج حاجتين, حرية وتعليم. تعليم. Education.
In order for these to change, two things are necessary, freedom and education.
لكن كل هذه الأشياء المصلحين بيقولوا دي لازم تتغير في الشرق الأوسط وفي بلادنا, وعلماء الدين كله بيقولوا ده لازم يتغير.
All scientists and people who are for the cause do agree that these things need to be changed in order for anything to happen.
لكن تعالوا نتنقل للحاجات اللي عليها خلاف.
Let's resume to the part to where there are differences in the beliefs.
قضية الختان.
The notion and the idea of women's circumcision in the area.
خلاف كبير قايم في الشرق الأوسط الآن حوالين هذه القضية. وهناك من بيقول ده جزء من الإسلام, وهناك بيقول الإسلام بيقول لا تضر المرأة. وأنا عملت برنامج طويل قدمت فيه الفكرة دي, إن أي حاجة تضر المرأة مرفوضة, لكن الخلاف مازال كبير ومش سهل حسمه.
There are two separate beliefs in which there are huge differences on how to approach the issue of women's circumcision. A lot of people believe that it is part of the religion, while others absolutely condone it and they don't believe in it. I myself have had a part of my program in which I completely discussed this idea, and I researched it as well.
النقطة الثانية اللي عليها خلاف شديد تولي المرأة للوظائف الكبرى زي رئاسة الدولة. وفي رأي بيقول ده حرام مرفوض في الإسلام, لكن في رأي تاني بيقول ده القرآن أثنى ومدح امرأة كانت رئيس الدولة, كانت ملكة, وإن ما فيش في الإسلام ما يمنع. وأنا قلت أيضا مثل هذا الرأي.
The second difference that people are having is women holding high positions or even a position like presidency. The Quran never said anything against it. In fact, it did It did mention an example of a woman holding such a position, and I believe that women should have the right to hold positions like that as well.
النقطة الثالثة تعدد الزوجات.
The third point is polygamy.
والخلاف شديد، والسؤال اللي أنا بسأله، هل تعدد الزوجات في الإسلام مطلق أم مقيد؟
The question I ask about that is, are there conditions for polygamy, or is it just a situation when you can have as many wives as you please?
واللي أنا مؤمن به إن التعدد مقيد بالظروف الشديدة، لأن الإسلام مش دين بيدعو للمثالية، هو دين واقعي يرتقي بالواقع. فالأصل هو واحدة، إلا لو عندك ظروف شديدة أو حصل ظروف غير عادية اضطرت للتعدد، لكن الأصل إنه هو مقيد في واحدة في بعض الآراء، وأنا أؤمن بهذه الآراء.
I personally believe that there are conditions if polygamy is to take place. Islam is not for pluralism, it's for reality. So if there are conditions that would make someone get married to somebody else, there have to be conditions that do apply to that. And I truly believe that there must be very good reasons for polygamy.
النقطة الرابعة اللي عليها خلاف، الجنس خارج مؤسسة الجواز.
The fourth point would be sex out of wedlock.
وهناك آراء بتقول افتحوا الحرية للمرأة في قضية ممارسة الجنس خارج مؤسسة الجواز كما تشاء، وهناك رأي بيقول ده في منتهى الخطورة وما ينفعش. وأنا مع الرأي الثاني في النقطة دي بالذات، لأن المجتمع الشرقي غير المجتمع الغربي، والسيستم الغربي في مثل هذه الأمور يختلف عن السيستم الشرقي، والمرأة هتضار ضرر شديد في العالم العربي لو فتحنا مسألة الجنس خارج مؤسسة الجواز.
Some people say they would like to give the women the option and the complete freedom to do as she pleases, while a lot of other people do believe that that may be a very dangerous step to give to women. Considering the differences between the West and the East, I believe that this would harm women a lot more than they would think, and I do agree with that opinion.
أنا تاني في الآخر عايز أقول هناك أمور متفق عليها إنها ظلم ولازم تتصلح، وهناك أمور عليها خلاف.
I would like to reiterate that there are some points that in which there are a lot of injustices and which we will discuss, and there are other points as well that enhance the point in the position of women.
والحل في وجهة نظري التعليم والحرية واستمرار الحوار علشان نعالج هذه المشاكل.
And the solution, in my opinion, is freedom, education, and continued communication.
And dialogue will be the solution between all of us. How can we solve these problems in the future? But to impose the culture will lead for more problems in the Middle East. Oh. It's your turn. Say it in Arabic, yeah?
I'll do that next time.
هناك تحدي آخر وظلم آخر. المرأة العربية في أماكن الصراع والحرب والمحن، المرأة في فلسطين والعراق ودارفور.
Another challenge and injustice that women go through are the places where women are, places of great conflict and war, like Iraq, Darfur, and Palestine.
وأنا اللي أنا بقوله لابد إن الصراع في هذه الأماكن يتجنب المدنيين، خاصة النساء والأطفال، وإن حضارة اليوم وكلنا مسؤولين لم تصل إلى رقي تجنيب المرأة والأطفال وإيلات الصراع.
And I do believe that this conflict must avoid women and children. Today's culture and the level that we have reached, we must consider women out of these political conflicts.
حضارة اليوم لازم ترتقي، لأن قتل المدنيين أو إيذاء المدنيين خاصة المرأة والطفل هيقود لمزيد من الصراع، وإن إحنا لازم يكون هناك ميثاق عالمي شديد لتجنب قتل المدنيين بالذات المرأة والأطفال.
Killing civilians only escalates the problem in the political situation that's already taking place. Our culture as a whole must elevate to a point to where we acknowledge that harming children will only make it worse, and we should always keep in mind that harm caused to children and women should always be kept aside and not allowed.
النقطة قبل الأخيرة أن أنا عايز أذكر بعض التجارب المتميزة اللي تمت في الشرق الأوسط لتحسين وضع المرأة.
And the point before last, I would like to share some of the last experiences taking place in the Middle East about women.
من الإنصاف إن أنا أذكر ثلاث نساء ليهم تجارب متميزة في تحسين وضع المرأة. الشيخة موزة في قطر ومشروع صلتك، الشيخة فاطمة زوجة الشيخ زايد في الإمارات ولها تجربة غير عادية في إصلاح وضع المرأة، المركز القومي للمرأة في مصر وما يقوم به السيدة سوزان مبارك من جهود بالذات في موضوع الختان وتقليل المشاكل بتاعته.
Out of fairness, I have to mention three women. Sheikha Moza of Qatar, Sheikha Fatma of the United Arab Emirates, and for the exceptional roles that they have done, and Suzanne Mubarak, especially in the idea and in the problem of women's circumcision.
آخر نقطة أحب أحكيها، المرأة في العالم العربي، هل هي مستعدة للتفعيل؟ هل هي جاهزة للعطاء والبذل ولا غير جاهزة؟
And the last point I would like to discuss is women's ability and their readiness to give to their community in the Middle East.
And let me give you my experience about this point. I started a program in 2002. This program called Life Makers. This program to start ask the youth, let's do some work for your countries. Let's be positive. And we started this program to millions of youth in the Middle East to tell them, let's work with us in many projects for our country, health projects, anti-drug campaigns, small business, many projects. And let me tell you that in 2003, in 2005, I'm sorry, we asked the youth, could you please send us your dreams for your country after 20 years from now? And I put this in my program in the television and in my website. We need your dreams. And we put about 26 sectors in my website, in education, in health, in economy, in all the sectors. Send me your dreams. And unfortunately, after 2 weeks, no one sent anything. You know why? Because no one asked them something like that before. What do you mean by dreams? So I started to explain to them what I mean by dreams. I told them, when America going to the moon, it was a dream. Can you imagine the first man who said we are going to the moon, what they said about him? The tunnel between London, between UK and France. Okay? It was like a dream. Dubai, it was like a dream. Think, give me your dreams. And I started to push them to send. We got in 2 months. Can you imagine how many dreams? 700,000. It's in my website till now. 700,000 dreams. Can I tell you that 70% of the people who send their dreams, women. Women. It was for me like a shock. What is this? Where is the men? But I understood at that time, oh, they want to do something. Just give them the chance. So next step, I said to them, oh, you send me now 700,000 dreams. But what can I do with all this? Could you please make priorities for your dreams? Can you please, we will put a counter in my website and we want each one to choose and we will put your dreams. And you will choose which dream is the first. What are the priorities? And we got, in another 2 months, 1 million reply. Counter. We put counter, 1 million in our counter. You know what they said? They said the first three things they want to start with. First, we need jobs. We want to work. Jobs. We want to respect ourselves. We need to work. This was number one. Second, women empowerment. We need to do something in our society. You left us in our homes. We need to work. Give us any chance to do something for our society. Women empowerment was number two. Can you imagine? Number three was the drug problem. Or our houses, or our lot of this problem in our country. This is the 3 points. So I said to them, we are going to make a survey to send us, we will ask you 16 questions, and this 16 question about the first problem, we need jobs. So please, could you send to us your reply about this survey? We got 1.4 million reply. 65% of the people who are talking about jobs was women. This survey, and I can send it to you to somewhere to the email to say what the women and youth said. Actually, this is part of my experience. In 05, after the cartoon crisis in Denmark, after what happened in Denmark, I went with 40 of the youth to make dialogue with the union of the Danish youth in Denmark. These 40, we did about 3,000 said, we want to go with you. And we chose just 40, the best 40. 25 of them with girls. And the leader of this team was girl. And you know from where they came? From Saudi Arabia. Very well educated. From Yemen, from Qatar, from Algeria, from Egypt. And this team went to Denmark to make this dialogue. I believe that women in the Middle East are ready to participate and to do a great job if we give her the chance to do something. Last month, we did a campaign, anti-drug campaign, for 5 weeks. And our goal in this campaign, we said we need 5,000 drug addicts. We want 5,000 to say we want to start the treatment program. And it was very difficult to get 5,000 in 5 weeks. So we did a team of 200 youth take a training course. How can they can do outreach to get these people, to get these 200, 100 of them girls. And they went to take this training course and they did a great job. Finally, I talked about 5 points. The most important thing that Islam as a principle and the original culture respect women. Second, let's talk about the overlap between culture. Don't impose the culture. We need to make dialogue. How can we make this overlap area more and more and more? The third thing, that there is injustice for women in the Middle East, yes, in many points like what we said. And these points, not before Islam, in my opinion, it's before education and freedom. And women in the Middle East are ready to work and participate in the society if we give her the chance. I'm so sorry if my language didn't help me And thank you for you, Dina. And I'm ready for any questions.
Hi. I'm not sure I can talk in front of everybody, but anyway. مرحباً بك. أهلاً بك. I just want to make a small addition to what you said, especially to the part of the religion and how Islam looks to women. Well, our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, خيركم خيركم لأهلي وأنا خيركم لأهلي, which means in English, the best man of you is the best to his wife and his daughters, and I am the best to my wife and my daughters. And from what we learn from the religion and the old books is that the way he treated women was, I think if I am treated like that now, I don't know what I would do. Because he, like, when Sayyida Fatma, his daughter, used to come from the room and he's sitting, he would get up and go to her and kiss her between her eyes and fold the robe that he's wearing for her to sit down on in front of everybody. That's out of respect to his daughter. And I think one of the main reasons why there is injustice to women in the Middle East, of course, all what Mr. Amr Khalid said, but in addition, and maybe on top of all of that, is that because most of the people are away from religion right now. They stepped back from the religion. Because the more religious a person becomes, he would be more to the teachings of the Quran, the teachings of the Prophet Muhammad, which says to be extremely respectful to women. To the smallest detail, as far as even if a man is capable enough money-wise to get his wife a servant, it's an obligation that he has her served. She has to be served at all times. I am an example for myself, which I live now with a very good husband, thank God, alhamdulillah. He does not, when I go to the car, he opens the door for me. He takes my car and put the oil and the gas. I don't do that. He brings servants. He spoils me, maybe. But he's carrying out the teachings that he's learned from our Prophet Muhammad, is a woman has to be very well served. Very well served. And when he was married to the Sayyida Aisha, one of his wives, he used to race with her. He used to make fun with her. He used to, when she was young, he used to get her toys. He used to take her to watch the people, you know, that were fighting and so on. And she keeps watching and watching until he asks her, are you done? She says, no. She says, okay, watch some more. And he keeps her watching and are you done? And until she says, well, I'm done. He says, that's okay, you can go now. So I think I've been living here for 30 years, which is a very long time. I've been here since I was 16 years old. And I think what is missing over here is that everybody in America needs to read about the true Islam, about the true Prophet Muhammad. And they need to know that we really are very peaceful people and we only have love to give. If there are some extremists that do anything wrong, you should not stick that to Islam. It has nothing to do with Islam. Like when, I don't remember the building that was bombed in Chicago, I think, or it was when, and they said it was some Muslim that did it, and then it was a Christian that did it. They didn't say he was Christian. They said he was an American, that he did it. But when an Arab person does something, he says, a Muslim did it, which is, I don't think it's fair, because really Islam is very wonderful. I just think it's fair.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. My question, I'm sorry, it is not in the heart of the topics, but it is relevant to Amr Khalid and the da'wah he conduct for Muslim people. In fact, the point is, you have a magic touch, like what they mentioned today. You have the magic touch and you appeal to a special group of people in the Muslim world, that is the youngster and us, the older also. My question is, what if you can, if you have a way throughout, you know, through so many years of da'wah you have been doing, if you have done some tweaking of the methods of the da'wah so that you can appeal to another group of people, which in fact they prohibit the progress of Islam in the Middle East. I'm talking about the rulers. Okay, I'm sure that you can do it. Okay, and by a little bit of tweaking of this methods. And I know that Allah have said in the Quran, وَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاةِ وَالْعَشِيِّ يُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَهُ. Yes, for the poor people and the religion come from the, but we are in the Middle East. We are in the 21st century. We have procedures, We have methods. We have ways of getting to this problem. And I'm sure you can do it, and I hope that you can do it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. ما عندي إجابة لا.
Assalamu alaikum. I had a question. So you discussed all the problems. How can we assist? What can we do to help resolve some of these issues that you discussed earlier?
كيف نقدر نحل
إيش ممكن يكون دورها هي في إنه تساعدك إنه تحل أو كدورنا إحنا كنساعدك تحل في الأمور هاي؟
يعني in my opinion the solution many of these problems you cannot change it through talking. Through work. Do you understand what I mean? We need women, the Muslim women, to start involved in the society, to help, to work, to make charities and to be volunteers in many projects. In my opinion, this is a practical step to change the situation. Let them go and do. And help. And believe me, when they start to work, many of the wrong mentalities of men in the Middle East will change, because they will found that did some concrete things and good efforts. In my opinion, the solution work and work, not just to talking. Islam give women many rights. We are good. Let's do something. Let's show. Even here, if you are Muslim here as a woman, work and help the society to show them this is how we can deal. To respect, to make them respect us. Do you understand me?
Saddam, assalamu alaikum.
Aye, salam.
You said there is two opinions in the Arab world between the having sex for the woman outside the marriage or in the marriage. Are you mean this difference between the ulama or between, like, just one clarification?
I meant the people who are talking about reforming in the Middle East. And some said, yes, give her all their opinion. But many of the scholars said, no, this is wrong and this is not acceptable. And I told you, we said that we have another system. So it's not applicable to do this in the Arab countries.
So this difference is not among the ulama, it's among just ulama and other people outside the people of knowledge of Islam.
Yes, that's what I said.
Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum. I have a quick question about something you said earlier in your speech. You mentioned that a woman went up to the father of a woman went up to the Prophet and asked and said that he wanted his daughter to marry the rich guy, but she wanted to marry the poor one. And he said, in response, she can only marry the guy that she loves, right? But our current understanding of Islam, or at least my current understanding of Islam, is that Islam encourages very limited interaction between men and women, especially pre-marriage. So how do you reconcile this concept of a woman loving a guy before she's to get married with him if they're not to meet or to have very limited interactions before they meet?
بيقول الإسلام بيقول بيحدد الالتقاء بين المرأة والرجل قبل الزواج. بس أنت بتقول في الإكزامبل اللي أنت عطيتهم إياه إنه الرسول قال للأب إنه تتزوج اللي هي بتحبه. فبيقول لك طب كيف ممكن نصلح هاي أو كيف ممكن تيجي بطريقة إنه طيب إذا في لازم يكون ما يكونش في كتير تعامل بين المرأة والرجل وتعطيها حرية إنه تتزوج اللي هي بتحبه.
أنا يعني I'm so sorry to ask you, where is the problem? Islam didn't say that no relation between men and women. I'm talking about العلاقة الجنسية. لكن نعم يعني فكرة التعارف المحترم وفكرة التعارف المحترم وفكرة العمل سويا وفكرة الحب كإحساس مين يقدر يعترض على هذا الكلام هذه مشاعر بشرية.
He said no one can object to love as a feeling and basically platonic friendships are allowable. They need to have interaction and that's her role in the workplace as well. So there's nothing that really doesn't allow her to form a relationship, but she's allowed interaction.
يعني مشاعر الحب مشاعر أمنية الارتباط فكرة العمل سويا إيه المشكلة في كل الكلام ده المشكلة بس في الموضوع الجنسي.
The only problem is that when it comes to sexual activities, otherwise, as far as social activities or getting to know someone and working with other people, that's not a problem.
Thank you.
Well, I've been waiting longer, but I'd like to allow the sister to ask her question first, since we're talking about them.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum. I fell in love with my husband the second meeting I saw him. So it was almost love at first sight. So just to clarify for the guy who is here, the first meeting was just very critical questions about what kind of married life he was looking for, so that I would know if he would be a good match or not. The second meeting was just pure love, and it did not require dating. It did not require anything. And past that, he asked to meet my father. I want to have your father's permission to get to know you. We got to know each other with the family's permissions, and then, you know, thank God, alhamdulillah, you know, I married a man that I love. I definitely loved him before I married him. But the thing I wanted to come up here and say is I also want to point out that within the Middle East, the countries, each country has its own culture. So there are microcultures within the culture of the Middle East. And even when we talk about issues like female circumcision, I'm a Palestinian by origin, and I've never heard of female circumcision until I came or immigrated to the United States, heard about it on the news that it was happening in some Middle Eastern country. And just now when you mentioned it, I turned to my friend and I said, you guys still do circumcision in, you know, in Egypt? And she said, yeah, sometimes. So even within the Middle East, each country has its own culture. And so when we talk about solutions and approaching these problems, that they might also differ from country to country. And you know, our approaches have to kind of be customized to each culture.
Thank you very much. I want to say something. I want to say that there is differences between cultures, our culture, and the Western culture, and there is overlaps values. There is differences, and there is overlaps values. I claim that the overlaps much more than the differences. And if we focus about our sharing values to make it more, to extend it and to say, here is the overlaps area, let's talk about this and let's focus about this, and instead of to focus about the differences, I think this will be much better. I was in Vienna 2 months ago, and a journalist came to me and she asked me, I want to make an interview with you. We started the first 7 questions talking about the differences. So I said to her, could you please ask me about our sharing values to talk about it? She said, but this will not be interested for the for the people in our. I said, here is the problem. You're talking about the something in interest, but this will lead for clash, more of clash. Why not to find where is the overlap and talk about it? And when we start talk about our overlaps area, we will start to listen to each other and like each other and feel that this is our humanity. I mean, when you find your values and my values, oh, we have the same value. So you feel much better. Then let's talk about, you have to change this. This is why this. Let me understand your culture in this. This is what I mean.
Thank you, sir. My name is Amir. I'm here on behalf of Islamic Dawah Center. We're an educational center here in downtown Houston, dedicated especially to foster a positive coexistence and constructive coexistence between Muslims and people of other faiths. What interests me of what you were talking about, you mentioned the overlaps. Since you came from back home and you have a really good experience of the Middle East cultures and the Western cultures through your travels, what is the most notable overlap that you have seen between our cultures? Notable or significant positive overlaps, similarities between our cultures and the Western cultures that you have seen, and how we can capitalize on that. Thank you again.
Thank you very much. هو بيسأل إيه أكتر مناطق الأوفرلاب مش كده بين
أنت تكلمت على ما الحاجات المشتركة ما بيننا وما بين
يعني I think when we talk about manners and ethics we're talking about a huge overlap area. When we're talking about to keep our world away from the extremism, we need jobs for the youth in the Middle East. And here, you can help in many of these projects to help youth in the Middle East to start their own small business projects. And I think these two areas, let youth in the Middle East work and find a good environment to work and get jobs. This is area, huge area. And if we start to work on this and help youth, especially in the Middle East, to find jobs, I think, and they found that, something concrete, not talking, they will feel that who did that with us, we feel a good relation with him in the future. This is one. Second, the ethics. Many of the ethics and manners area is we sharing the same values in these manners. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, and it's an honor for me to be here. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.